Yes, Sirvan, on the face of it, let's continue the chapter from this point. Like Mr. Lam says that because the boy had always been counseled by his parents to protect himself from others, the parents had been, you know, telling the child to save himself, not to listen to the people's views and all. So the boy had been living in the under the impression that he needs to be protected from other people. So he had that inferiority complex for no reason, because he had not been able to realize so far that he is a boy with all faculties working very well. He didn't know that he is otherwise a very capable boy, the one who has got all parts of his body working well. So this is what the boy man is telling him, like, Lord boy, oh Lord, oh my God. You have got two arms, two legs, and eyes and ears. You've got a tongue and a brain. You'll get on the way you want, like all the rest. And if you choose, and if you chose and set your mind to it, you could get on better than all the rest. How? Same way as I do. Do you have any friends? Hundreds. But you live by yourself in that house. It's a big house too. Friends everywhere. People come in, everybody knows me. The gate is always open. They come and sit here and in front of the fire in winter. Kids come for the apples and pears and for toffee, and I make toffee with honey. Anybody comes in, so have you. So Mr. Lam wants to point out, like, we are all surrounded by people all around. Like, there is no dearth of friends around us. Okay, it is only about our acceptance. It's only our, you know, open-heartedness which makes us become friends with others and others with us. So he says, Daddy is still withdrawn. He says, I'm not a friend. Certainly you are. So far as I'm concerned, what have you done to make me think that you are not my friend? You don't know me. You don't know where I come from or even what my name is. So what should that signify? Do I have to write all your particulars down and put them in a filing box before you can be a friend? I suppose no. You could tell me your name if you chose, and if not, if you didn't. Dari, only it's Derek. But I hate that, Dari. If I'm your friend, you don't have to be mine. I choose that. Certainly, I'm your friend. I might never come here again, and you might never see me again, and then I couldn't still be a friend. Why not? How could I? You pass people in the street and you might even speak to them, but you never see them again. It doesn't mean they are friends. So Daddy has got such narrow views about friends. But Mr. Lam has got very open views. He says that doesn't mean they are enemies. Like, if somebody is not your friend, then doesn't mean that they are your enemies. So does it? No, they are just nothing. People, that's all. So they are just people. People are never just nothing, never. So Mr. Lam is telling him, like, people are just never nothing. People are everything. Daddy, there are some people I hate. So Daddy is full of hatred for most of the people. That's why he's not able to digest the concept that anyone can be your friend. So Daddy says that there are some people I hate, Mr. Lam. That would do you more harm than any bottle of acid. Acid only burns your face. So hatred burns you from within. And acid has burnt only your outer side, but hatred will burn you from within also. So Daddy is startled at only, because he is obsessed with his face. Then how can only, if his face is burnt, how can it be only for him? Like a bomb only blew up my leg. There is worse things can happen. You can burn yourself away inside. So Mr. Lam tells him that there is no end to the worst things. Like, it's, he only got half face of his burnt. He only got his half face burnt. Mr. Lam got only his one leg blown off. Because the loss could have been quite bigger one, but it was not that big. So Daddy, and I had come home. When I would come home, one person said, he would have been better off stopping in there, in the hospital, in the hospital, he would better be off with others like himself. She thinks blind people only ought to be with other blind people and idiot boys with the idiot boys. So here Derry is talking about the view of other people who think that blind people should be kept with blind people and idiots with idiots. But children, you must be knowing it that now this concept doesn't work. Okay, if we talk about inclusive education, and then we mean that all the children, despite without regard to their gender or financial status or their mental ability or their physical ability, they are all supposed to be together. Okay, there has not to be this kind of distinction what is being pointed out here. Mr. Lam says, and people with no legs altogether. That's right. What kind of world would that be? At least there would be nobody to stare at you because you weren't like them. So Mr. Lam, so you think you are just the same as all the other people with burnt faces, just by what you look like. Everything is different and everything is same, but everything is different, isn't it? So Mr. Lam is striking a big paradox in these lines. He says that how can you be sure that when everything is different, when everything is the same, can everything be different? Can everything be same when everything appears to be same? If all blind people are kept together, can you say that all those blind people are same? Yes or no? If we keep all the lame people together, can we say that all those lame people are similar? They might be similar because of one disability, but they will be all different because of their abilities. One might be a very good artist, one might be a very good singer, one might be a very good scientist, one might be a linguist. So each and everybody might appear to be similar, but in the end they are all different. But in the end they are all similar because they are all human beings. So this is a strange paradox, which makes us realize that we cannot imagine any two people being similar. So how do you make all that out? So Derry is startled at how intelligent or how wise Mr. Lam is. He says, like, how are you able to make out such great things? So Mr. Lam's answer is that watching, listening, and thinking makes him wise. So children, that's a key to become wise in life also. Okay? There happen to be some children, there happen to be some people, those who are not able to make out even when the things are in front of them because they are poor observers. They don't listen. Even when I'm speaking something to you people, there might be somebody who might be sitting dumb without his ears working. So watching, listening, and thinking makes us wise. So Derry says, I would like a place like this, a garden. I would like a house with no curtains. So he likes this place, garden. He likes a house where there is no curtain. Mr. Lam says the gate is always open. What does it mean? That if you like it, then be here, come here. But this isn't mine. Everything is yours if you want it. What's mine is anybody's. So I could come here again. So could I come here again? Even if you were out, I could come here? Certainly. You might find others here, of course. Oh, well, that needn't stop you. You need not mind. It would stop them. They would mind me. When they saw me here, they look at my face and run. So Mr. Lam says that if you find somebody here, then you should not bother about that. So Derry says, it's not me who will bother, but it is those people who will bother about me. Because the moment they will look at my face, they will be scared and they will run away. Mr. Lam says, they might or they might not. Means there is a possibility that they might run away. But there is one more possibility that they might not run away. You would have to take the risk. So would they. So the point is that you'll have to take risk. No, you would. You might have me and lose all your other friends because nobody wants to stay near me if they can help it. So Derry says that it is you who will be taking the big risk. Because if you will make me your friend, then all other people will not be your friends. So Mr. Lamb, I have not moved. No. When I go down the street, the kids shout Lammy Lamb, but they still come into the garden, into my house. It's a game. They are not afraid of me. Why should they be? Because I am not afraid of them. That's why not. So Mr. Lamb makes it clear, like it's all give and take. So if you are afraid of them, that's why they are also afraid of you. But if you won't, then even they will not be afraid of you. Right? So Daddy says, did you get your leg blown off in the war? Certainly. How will you climb on a ladder and get the crab apples down then? So now Daddy is able to think about the problem of others. So far, he had been only thinking about his own face. But now he has realized that how difficult the life of this man is. He is lame, then even then he is able to climb up the tree. Even then he is able to pluck the apples. So now he's asking him, like, how do you do all this? Yes, Mr. Lamb, oh, there are a lot of things I've learned to do and plenty of time for it. Years, I take it steady. So Mr. Lamb points out that he has learned to do so many things with his one leg. And moreover, he has got plenty of time for it. He has taken years to practice all these things. If you fell and broke your neck, you could lie on the grass and die if you were on your own. So Daddy says something over here. And these words are very ironic because what Daddy is saying, it will actually come true in the end. This is an irony used here in the play. He says that if you will climb up the tree, then you might fall. You might fall on the grass and then you might die. And it will actually happen in the end of the play. So Daddy said this just out of fear. Mr. Lamb, I could. So Daddy, you said I could help you if you want to. But my mother will want to know where I am. It's 3 miles home across the fields and I'm 14. But they still want to know where I am. So Daddy says that, okay, I can stay back with you. But the problem is that my mother might be waiting for me. And she might be expecting that I should tell her that where I am. And moreover, my house is 3 miles away from this place. And I'm only 14 years of age. But still, my parents think that I should tell them where I am. So Mr. Lamb says, people worry. So he doesn't say like mother, your mother worry. He says, people worry. Daddy says, people fuss. So see the difference in attitude. So Mr. Lamb is positive in his opinion also. He says that, yes, people always worry. But he says, people fuss. So there is a big difference between these two words. And Mr. Lamb says, go back and tell them. It's 3 miles. It's a fine evening. You've got legs. Once I got home, they would never let me come back. So Daddy says there is one more problem. That once if I go home, then my parents will not let me come back. Mr. Lamb says, once you got home, you would never let yourself come back. So Mr. Lamb says, it's not the others. It's you only. You will not let yourself come back. Means it's only an excuse. Like your parents will stop you. The reality is that we do what we wish. Mr. Lamb says, Daddy says, you don't know. You don't know what I could do. So now Daddy is realizing his caliber. He says, you don't know what I can do. Daddy, Mr. Lamb, no, only you know that. Mr. Lamb says, yes. Your caliber, what you can do, what your potential is, only you can. You know this. How can I know this? Then Mr. Lamb, if you chose. So I don't know everything. I don't know everything, boy. I can't tell you what to do. So Mr. Lamb is very clear. He never ever forces. He never ever, force his opinion upon others. If Mr. Lamb is able to change Daddy from a scared boy to a confident boy, then it is because Mr. Lamb is a perfect counselor. He addresses the boy's sick mentality, the boy is able to make out like he's a fully capable boy. with two eyes, with two ears, with one tongue, with the, you know, intelligence, with the two legs, two arms. So that gave him the courage, that gave him the confidence about what he can do. Right? Okay. Then Dari says, they tell me, do you have to agree? So Dari says, they tell me to stay back. Then Mr. Lamb's point is, like, do you have to agree to each thing what others say? I don't know what I want. I want something no one else has got or ever will have. Something just mine, like this garden. I don't know what it is. So Dari is able to make out now that what his ambition is. So children, when you are able to realize some aim in life, it means that you are not lost. You people might have seen people or children around you, those who say, I don't know what I have to do. So those kinds of people happen to be lost. So he says that, like, I don't know what I want, but I want something which no one otherwise has been able to get. For example, I want this garden. Mr. Lamb, you could find out how? Waiting, watching, listening, sitting here or going there, I'll have to see to the bees. So you can, the Mr. Lamb doesn't want to waste much of his time in telling the boy to come back, this, that. He says, okay, now it is all up to you. You can, Mr. Lamb says that you can wait, you can watch, and you can listen. So he says, like, I'll be sitting here and I'll be, I have to see the bees. Those other people who come here, do they talk to you, ask you things? Some do, some don't. I ask them, I like to learn. Then Dari, I don't believe in them. I don't think anybody ever comes. You are here all by yourself and miserable. And no one would know if you are alive or dead. And nobody cares. So Dari says that you are saying that people come, but I think nobody comes. And nobody here even knows whether you are alive or not. Mr. Ram says, you think what you please. Means all, it's your opinion. Dari, all right then, tell me some of their names. Then Mr. Lamb says, what are names? Tom, Dick, or Harry? Getting up, I am off down to the bees. So Mr. Lamb doesn't want to, you know, have this kind of conversation where Mr. Lamb will have to become depressed. So Mr. Lamb says, okay, now I'm going down to the bees. I think you are daft, crazy. Daft means silly. What for? Mr. Lamb says, that's a good excuse. What for? You don't talk sense. Good excuse not to come back. And you have got a burnt up face, and that's other people's excuse. So Dari says, I think you are silly. Then Mr. Lamb says, that is your excuse for not to come back. And you've got a burnt face. That is the excuse with other people. Dari says, you are like the others. You like to say things like that. If you don't feel sorry for my face, you are frightened of it. And if you are not frightened, you think I am ugly as a devil. And I'm a devil, don't you? So Dari again comes back to the same point. The moment Mr. Lamb says that you've got a burnt face, and that is the excuse of other people not to talk with you. So there is nothing in how we look like. If we like somebody, we may not have any excuse. So Dari says, like, you are also like other people. Basically, you are also afraid of my face. So when he says the same thing again in the end, then Mr. Lamb does not reply. He has gone to his bees. Now, Mr. Lamb, he finds no point in talking to Dari about this. He had done his job. Now, Dari, quietly, no, you don't. I like it here. But Dari, in the heart of his heart, knows that Mr. Lamb is not like that person. And moreover, he likes being in the garden. Then there is a pause. Dari gets up and shouts, I'm going, but I'll come back. You see, you wait. I can run. I haven't got a tin leg. I'll be back. So Dari has got his confidence back. So now he's shouting. He's telling Mr. Lamb that he will be back. And because, why will he be back? Because he has got two legs. He has not got a tin leg that he can't run. So he can run, so he will be back. So Dari runs off. So there is silence, the sounds of the garden again. Now Mr. Lamb, now Dari has gone, Mr. Lamb is all alone, and he talks to himself. What he says, there, my dears, that's you, That's you seen too. Ah, you know, we all know, I'll come back. They never do, though, not them, never do come back. So this dialogue of Mr. Lamb, children, it's about his, it's about the loneliness or the kind of alienation he also suffers from. Throughout now, till now we have been able to make out like Mr. Lamb is very happy. People come to him, people talk to him, and he has got many friends. But here we come to know that yes, Mr. Lamb suffers from the pangs of loneliness. No one comes to him. And he also yearns for somebody's company. So he says, they are my dears. That's you seen too. Ah, you know, we all know. I'll come back. They never do, though, not them, never do come back. The garden noises fade. So Mr. Lamb points out that there are many people who always make promises that they would come back, but they never come back. Okay, so Mr. Lamb is not hopeful about Darry's arrival now. So Darry has gone and Mr. Lamb is all alone and he is hardly hopeful about Darry's arrival, right? That was scene one, where we saw Darry coming to Mr. Lamb's garden and interaction of Darry with Mr. Lamb makes the gates of opportunity or gates of optimism open for him. So Darry, who was earlier a withdrawn, defiant, silent, frightened boy, now he has become a courageous boy who has realized, like, he has caliber, that he has the potential. He has realized his strengths. What his strength is, that he has been made a fully capable or fully formed boy with all body parts, with intelligence working very well. So when we have got our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, intelligence, and then arms and legs working well, it means that we have got the whole wealth of the world. Okay. So it's only our mental sickness. It's only, our pessimism, which doesn't let us live life. And the best way to shun pessimism is look at the brighter side of life. Okay. Be hopeful. Think about the positive things. So this is what Darry has been able to make out. Now we will see in scene two whether Darry is able to convince his parents. We will now see meet Darry's mother also, the one who has been able to overprotect her child up to the extent that the child never realized his potential. She made the child live in the shelter of, pessimism and all. And now Darry will tell mother that he will have to go to the old man, because if he would not step out of his shell, he will never be able to. So now we will see a new Darry coming out of his shell. So that we will do tomorrow. Now the time is over. So scene two will start tomorrow, right?